So we need to pray consciously. We need to pray deliberately. We need to pray repeatedly, and we also need to pray consistently. Whenever we face any challenge, you know, you see, you think about it. All you have to think about is what happens when you forget about God and leave Him out of the affairs of our daily life. And the result is we have frustration, we have irritation, we have a lack of peace, we have a lot of short tempers, and discouragement. But when we invite God into our daily life, when we pray to God, there is peace, there is joy, there is a sense of knowing that the Lord is looking upon us, looking out for us all the time, giving us a helping hand. The third item that I want to talk about this morning is be thankful in every circumstances. In everything, be thankful. The question revolves around the expression in everything, or in some other versions it says in every circumstances. We know we need to be thankful to God whenever good things happen to us. You know, we need to praise God when we have a windfall, or when our kids are doing well at school, or when we are doing well at work, or when we get a promotion. Because we shouldn't take our blessings for granted and think that maybe sometime, somehow, we deserve blessings, right? We shouldn't take that for granted. But sometimes, if you think about it, if we only give thanks when we have money in the bank, or when our marriage is good, or when the bill goes through, or when the church is growing, or when your friend is glad to see you, then what will you do when trouble comes along? What will you do if your company downsizes and you're out of job? Or what will you do if your investment loses 50% of its value? Or what will you do if your friends betray you? It is in those hard moments that we must return to God, whose love for us does not change. When I was flying into Launceston last year for one of our sisters, you know, Queen Tetosnoops, she passed away in September. There were quite a few of us that went along to the funeral in Launceston. And our flight was delayed because it was too foggy on the ground for the plane to land. So we were circling up on the air. Down below, in the ground, they couldn't see anything because it was so foggy. But up above the fog, it was clear as anything, you know. It was clear as anything. The sun was shining brightly. Sometimes, when the fog of life seems to obscure the face of our Father, when that lifts, then we see the sun that shines above. Sometimes we think that when we are in hardship, we think that we are in a fog and we couldn't see. But in reality, above that, the sun is shining bright. In our hardship, the Lord is working for us as hard as He could. Sometimes we just need to remember that. And if you think about it, what is it that we have to be thankful for? A few things that I want to let you consider. We want to First of all, that our God is sovereign. That the God that causes all things to work together for good for His children. That the hard times reveals our weakness, breaks our pride, and shows us our total need on God. We can be thankful that God has triumphed over sin and death through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We can be thankful that God is faithful even when we are faithless. We can be thankful that God's promises are true. We can be thankful that when we are weak, He is strong. We can be thankful that His grace is sufficient for every situation. We can be thankful that our salvation rests on God and not on ourselves. We can be thankful that God delights in saving sinners. We can be thankful that even when we feel alone, we are never alone. We can be thankful that God will not cast us beyond what we can bear. We can be thankful that the Lord Jesus Christ feels our pain. We can be thankful that Jesus will intercede for us so that we can be finally saved. We can be thankful that God's plan far exceeds our puny imagination. And most of all, we can be thankful that nothing, absolutely nothing, can separate us from the love of God. Romans chapter 8. He says, the inspired apostle Paul said, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? In verse 37 he says, yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. I've lived long enough to know that behind every smiling face there is a story. A brother, Elvis, talked about that this morning. Behind even the happiest person, they have their own share of sorrow. Some people seem to receive far more than their share of pain. But if we are left to ourselves, the pain of life will drive us to bitterness and ultimately to despair. But when we factor God into the equation, it is then and only then that we can have the grounds to say, thank you, Lord, no matter what happens to us. It's then and only then that we can be thankful in all circumstances. So, my conclusion for this morning. What is God's will for us in 2019 and beyond? Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks. This is the will of God Christ Jesus for you. As an example, if you want to follow someone, turn with me if you can to Ezra chapter 7, verse 10. Ezra chapter 7 verse 10. An example, someone we can follow. Ezra chapter 7 verse 10. But before that, in verse 8, we were told that Ezra came to Jerusalem. In verse 8, Ezra came to Jerusalem in the 5th month. So we have the 5th month. Right? In verse 9, we were told, on the first day of the first month, he began his journey from Babylon. So we have the first day, first month. It is the journey that took him more than 4 months. 4 months from Babylon to Jerusalem. And see, listen to what he says in verse 9. He came to Jerusalem according to the good hand of his God upon him. So, he did that because of the good hand of God. It's a long journey, 4 months from Babylon to Jerusalem. And he was able to do that because of the good hand of his God upon him. In verse 10, that's the reason why. In verse 10, it says, for, that's the reason. For Ezra has prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord. That is what we need to do. Prepare. What? To seek the law of the Lord. That's why. For Ezra has prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord. Not just that, he said, and to do it. This morning, I want to encourage everyone here to use Ezra as an example to us. An example that he set before us to first of all prepare our heart to seek the law of the Lord. Second, to actually do what it says. And not just that, we need to spread the good news, teach others about it. And when we do that, we are sure that the good hand of the Lord will grow in us. If you have any need at all this morning, won't you come forward as we stand to sing some of the invitation songs to God?
As a thousand graves for you and me, let us take our place to the grave. It's the power of love from the source of love, and it is a soft religion.
Thank you.